Right. So here we are. So actually, this course will be covered by two faculties. My name is, I introduce myself as well. My name is Dildar Khan. I am an electrical and electronics engineer, and I have an experience of 5 to 6 years in this field. I've been teaching for 3 to 4 years. We have divided our courses into two parts. One is complete internal logic and all the concepts that are required to deal with the laptop repairing. And other part is the practical thing, everything that deals with the practical knowledge. So we'll have two parts, and everything will be bifurcated in those two categories. So one category will be dealt with me, Dildar, and the other category will be dealt with Mr. Nasir sir, who has an experience of 15 years in this laptop chip level repairing. He has been repairing since his childhood, and he'll tell you a practical experience that you can ever get. And I am here to tell you all the logics that you stuck in. Okay, we will have a perfect combination of theory as well as practical, so that you can come out as a complete engineer, not as a practical engineer or as a theoretical engineer. You will be coming out as a complete engineering field student, having a very good experience in both the fields. Okay, so we'll start with our basic thing. As you know, if your base is strong, you can build a 25-story building. So we are going to start with this switching section. Okay, the basic building block of any motherboard repairing, any motherboard you take, if you go with mobile repairing, or you go with motherboard, or you go with the laptop or desktop motherboard, you will deal with all these components. Everybody thinks that they all know this, but actually they don't know actual concept of this. If you know everything, every actual basic understanding of all these components, you are not going to stuck anywhere. As Prabhjit is stuck in a capacitor, and now he is doing a laptop repairing course. So a little thing can change your motive and change your perspective of seeing anything. So we'll do each and everything in details. We'll start slowly, very slow. You might see that this chapter is lethargic, but it is necessary. We'll start very slow, and we'll change the gears. From 1 to 6, you'll go from 1 to 6, and you'll cope up with that. I can guarantee you. So we'll be having switching sections in which we'll deal with resistor, the most basic component. Then we'll deal with inductors, that we call coil, and the capacitor, the favorite topic of Prabhjit. We'll do with capacitor also. What is the shorting level? How we check capacitor? What is the value of a capacitor? What are the leakage? All the components that we'll see, we'll go through step by step. PN junction diode, you know, all know what is a diode, and the other form of diode is Zener diode that we use in a reverse direction. We'll see, we'll go through that also. BJT, bipolar junction transistor, how a BJT is useful, and what are the application of BJT, that we'll see also. After that, we'll go through MOSFET. The most used component on motherboard repairing is the MOSFET. Everyone must have come across this component. Am I right? MOSFET, you all know. MOSFET is the basic building block of every motherboard. In every motherboard, you'll see MOSFET, MOSFET, only MOSFET. Everywhere MOSFET, MOSFET, and capacitor. So these, if you know everywhere only these components, then why you get stuck in understanding I/O, PCH, CPU? They have been built very minutely. They have been built very carefully by the manufacturer. But these components, resistor, inductor, capacitor, diode, Zener, BJT, MOSFET, gates, op-amp, these are not given so much importance. They are cheap elements. So the manufacturer also know if this gets damaged, then it's not a big cost. Okay. But if IC gets damaged, or the PCH or CPU gets damaged, that will be a bigger challenge for the manufacturer. So in the switching section, what we will cover for each topic, as I said, all these 10 topics, what we will cover in each topic that I have explained here, all the switching components, working principle, how they work, what is the principle of their working, how they are switch off, how they are switch on, how the current will pass through that, how the voltage will be stored in that, everything will go through that. After that, we'll go through the schematic. If you know that this is a resistor, this is a capacitor, this is a coil, then in schematic, how these things are working and how they are placed, and how we have to trace on the schematic. Because when you get a fault, everyone is there, no? Nobody is missing?
Yeah.
I think five and six. Okay, everyone is there, right? So what we'll go through the schematic, the diagram. if you know, there is a manual that you get when you buy a mobile or any laptop, you get a manual. That manual is this motherboard schematic. You can do everything and anything using this schematic if you have mastery in this. So I'll be focusing on this main thing. This is the schematic. Schematic will be my main focus. Everybody can take a motherboard and remove one component each time and replace it one by one. Then the motherboard may get solved. Anyone can solve single board in a single day if he replaces all the components. But if he knows how to read a schematic, if he understands what is the logic of a schematic, then he will be able to solve 10 times better and 10 boards more than that person. So, and after that, when you know the working principle of each component, after that, I'll tell you how to find the faults in those components. First, we'll see the shorting. What is the shorting? How we'll be able to find the shorting of any component? How we'll understand it is open or there is a leakage in that component? There is a minute difference between a leakage and an open. Okay, we'll go through that when we get into the details. I'm just giving you the overview what we are going to cover in this. It may take a whole class, but you have to understand this first. And we'll go through some basic electronics as well, because everybody is not from the electronics background. So there is a requirement of basic understanding of the electronics, that what is the current that is going to flow in this resistor. If you talk about PSID, and in that PSID there is a current and there is a resistor also, and that resistor is always faulty. Why you say that resistor is faulty? If I ask you a reason why you say that resistor is faulty, you cannot answer it, because you don't know what is the Ohm's law. Voltage divider, the most common structure of resistor used in the motherboard is voltage divider. You all know that. What is a voltage divider? We'll see the application, actual application, what, how we can change the voltage divider's value and get a different motherboard working. Okay, we'll see through that. Current divider, not very much used in motherboard, but we'll see also that somewhere it may be used. So you should know what is a current divider also. Still KVL, that is included in voltage and current divider only. Current and voltage calculation on actual motherboard schematic. We'll see how you want to say that this ampere current is going to flow through this resistor. We'll see through that also. A basic electronics we will cover here as well. Conductor and semiconductor, that you all know, maximum component that are used on our motherboard is a semiconductor, not a conductor. Okay, why that is, we'll go through this. Okay, so polarity concept of voltage and current. What are the polarities of the voltage? How to determine the, if you say there is a negative current protection, if any motherboard or any data sheet of a charging IC says that it has a negative current protection, what do you mean by negative current protection? You should have understanding what is a positive current, what is a negative current, what is the positive voltage, what is a negative voltage. There should be a basic understanding. Okay, now after that, we'll enter in the actual motherboard field. Okay, this is the first step towards the motherboard working. This is a 19 volt DC in section. With the first supply, now I'll start asking question, because now I think you are getting bored. So unmute your mics and get ready to answer. Prabjeep is already unmuted.
Yeah.
So what are the voltages that are used in the motherboard? What are the voltages?
19 volts, 3.3 volts.
And that I can see here, it is already written.
Apart 1.8, from this. 1.85 volts, 1 volt,
okay.
1.04 or 1.2.
1.05 like PCH supply.
1.05, okay. Yeah, 1.05.
Okay, and anyone else? There is a, it means there are two types of regulator. I'm getting into this topics also. So there are two types of regulator. One is a step down regulator and the one other one is a step up regulator. Okay, when you go from 19 volt to 3 volt, 5 volt, 1.05 volt, 1.8 volt, 0.9 volt, 0.75 volt, this is a step down converter. Okay, and when you go from 19 volt to 28 volt, that is a step up converter. Okay, so we will see what are they working and how to determine that if it is working fine or not. Okay, and you'll understand the logic also, how 19 volt is getting converted to 28 volt. How come is that possible? Aapke paas 100 rupees hai, if you have only 100 rupees, and how can you spend 120 rupees? But here we can. How that is possible, we'll go through that. Have you heard about the charge pump Have you seen 8204 RT8204 IC, which has a charge pump supply that gives 15 volt output that goes to the run section and changes the voltage from suspend to run? After that, we'll see the different architecture. There is a 19 volt supply that is coming in into the motherboard. How it is getting inside the motherboard? You have just applied the adapter there. That is a 19 volt supply, mm-hmm. right? Now, how it is going to enter into the motherboard? That will be defined by the different architecture of 19 volt. So, if you understand the basic function, what are the basics that we should know to deal, right? So 19 mm-hmm. volt different architecture, we'll go through 5 to 6 to 7 architecture, and I'll give you one more thing. I forgot to tell you, I'll give you some homework as well, okay? Because if I only tell you everything and you just take it and you just go and sleep, then it will be gone. If you don't work on it, then only it can stay with you. You have to work on it, okay? I'll teach you 4 to 5 architecture, and I'll give you 3 to 4 architecture as well. You'll have 4 to 5 days gap after each class. You will have 4 to 5 days gap. You have to complete in those days that section, and then we'll discuss it, okay? Right. After that, you'll go through the problems related to the motherboard. So if you know that if 19 volt is not getting inside the motherboard, it means the motherboard is in a dead condition, right? If first supply is not inside the motherboard, then that motherboard is in dead condition, right, Jack?
Yes, that's right.
Yes. So that problem could be due to many reasons. Okay. That problem could be many, many reasons. As in case of PUBG, that was due to shorting of a MOS of a capacitor. Okay. Mm-hmm. That can be due mm-hmm. to opening of a MOSFET. That can be due to charging IC as well. That can be due to SIO controller as well. There could be n number of reasons for this dead laptop motherboard, right? So we'll go through all the logic. Understand one thing. If you know a single case study that you have seen my YouTube channel, na? Everybody has seen my YouTube channel. You must have seen that I put solution as well. Problem is there, solution is there. But by seeing that video only, you can solve that motherboard only.
That solution only.
Okay,
yeah.
You can solve that motherboard only. But if a different motherboard comes, or if a same motherboard comes with a different problem, you will not be able to solve that, right?
Gotcha.
So it is not for my use, because you can solve a motherboard seeing that video. That is a different thing. But if you know the concept, you can solve 100 motherboards. Okay? If you know the concept, you can solve 100 motherboards. I want to tell you that. So you must focus. Don't focus on the case now. Focus on the learning. If you learn it, you can solve all the motherboards. Not all. I myself don't solve all the motherboards. You can solve 90% of the cases. Okay. Don't think that you will solve 100%. Think that you will solve 90%. If you are solving 9 out of 10 motherboard, you are a good engineer. Now let's get to the next slide. Basic triggering logic of motherboard. So once 19 volt is adapter, if you are putting this adapter, you can see this adapter. If you're putting this adapter in the motherboard, then it is just giving the 19 volt supply to the board, na? But that 19 mm-hmm. volt supply needs to go at different regions of the motherboard, on different ICs of the motherboard. That is determined by the triggering logic of the motherboard. Okay? When IO gets triggered, when I'm talking about triggering, what is the meaning of triggering? That is, in 90% case, that is an IO triggering. Super IO, or yes. ECU call it, or KBC you call it. That is a controller. Mm-hmm. Okay, so we were discussing about the basic triggering logic, and I've given you all the examples that I think that's sufficient to tell you that. So there could be a different logics. What are the those logics that are really responsible for these motherboard to get triggered? There's a 51 on logic concept. I've put a lot of videos on this on YouTube as well. We'll go through this, the real actual concept. What is a 51 on logic that is used to trigger any motherboard? This is used in mostly in Acer motherboards. We'll go through that as well. PSID, I have already discussed this. PSID is power supply ID. What is the use of this PSID concept, and how it will cause problems? Main thing is, if you know everything and if you are not able to solve problem, then that knowledge is of no use. You should be able to solve mm-hmm. problem as well. So that PSID, what are the problems that could be solved with this concept? We'll go through that as well. PSL logic, you must have gone through this as well. in Cedar motherboards, in Dell Cedar motherboards, you will see in the Wistron manufacturing, you will see the PSL logic, the power supply logic. Okay, you will see how have you, do you know what are the requirements of an IoT gate trigger? One more thing I want to tell you, that you all know that we will, after completion of the course, if there is new thing, like if there comes new thing, like 10th generation, 11th generation, 12th generation, then you don't need to pay for that also. You will get live class for that, as we are doing right now. You will get that as well when, if even even when your course is completed. Okay, so we will be connected for lifetime. We are in a chain for lifetime. Maybe my life is not so long, but whenever it ends, we'll be connected till then, right? The 3-volt, 5-volt standby section. We'll go after understanding the we have understood 19-volt section now. What is the working of 19-volt? Now we'll go to the 3-volt, 5-volt section. What is the working of 3-volt, 5-volt section? What are its uses? What are the ICs that are used with it? And what is its internal logic, right? For that, you have to understand basic difference between an LDO and a switching regulator. What is a switching regulator? Okay. After that, the more specific that with Labtex is, we go with the internal logic. Okay. We just don't say that this signal goes from this to this, then this goes to that, then this goes to that, then board is on. We don't go through that superficial knowledge. We go with the actual internal logic, how your brain is working. After that, there are different ICs that I have named here. RT8204, 8243, that is a coding of ATA equal to, and TPS512125. RT key bhi padhenge hum log, and we will also go to the TPS ICs as well, right? The different manufacturer ICs. We'll cover two ICs in each section with its working and internal concept. I'll give you how I read motherboard, or how I read any data sheet or any IC's internal logic. I'll tell you that concept. Okay, how I read it, that makes me that makes my life easy. I'll tell you that concept with that logic as well, so that you, when you come across new ICs, then you will be able to understand easily what are the different problems that you come across. 3-volt, 5-volt missing, 3-volt, 5-volt not generating, only 3-volt is available, 5-volt is not available. If there is 3-volt is coming as 2-volt and 5-volt is coming as 4-volt, then what you have to do? If it is coming, 3-volt is coming as 6-volt and 5-volt is coming as 8-volt, then what you have to do? That is the different problems. Problem will not be so simple that you remove IC and problem is solved. Problem can be a different exaggerated problem as well. You have to understand logic, then you will solve any of these problems. Any means 90%. If I say any of these problems means 90%, 10% I myself don't solve. How come I say you that you can solve? Okay. Now we'll move to the next section, that is charging section, right? So what is the use of a charging section? What are the common faults that are related to this section? Note down the problem that I'm saying you. Plugin not charging, adapter not detect, percentage not increasing, laptop is my battery is slow charging, fast discharging, okay? Or you can say it is showing 255% charge or 1000% charge. You must have come across these problems, okay? And sometimes what will happen, that motherboard is running on adapter but not on battery. It is running on battery but not on adapter. Have you come across these problems? Definitely you must have come across these problems. Maybe you don't remember those, but these are the problems that you must have. If you have not come across, you will come across these problems in your future if you're gonna do motherboard repairing. These are the problems that you're gonna face, and that all problems we'll deal here with our concept. Not just say, if I say you plug-in not charging, that could be solved with 20 different components. There could be problem with 20 different components. If I have put 3 to 4 videos on plug-in not charging, I'm going to put another one on this Saturday. And mind you, parallel to this class, you must follow my YouTube channel.
Can charging IC, because I have a Dell.
Yeah.
That is directly connected to the first two MOSFETs. I think it is measuring the current, how much is going to actually actuate the charging circuit or not. Is it possible that the charging circuit can stop laptop from booting?
Of course. 19 volt if it is not right? if 19 volt is not entered into motherboard, how come motherboard can boot? No, possible.
But what if your charging IC is blown or maybe it is shorted or something like that?
Yeah.
Then can it stop the laptop from booting, right?
Understand one thing.
Yeah.
That DC in section you have talked about, the 19 volt motherboard and entry section, that could be, as I told you, there could be different logic to switch that 19 volt. There could be IO who is responsible for switching the 19 volt. There could be charging IC who is responsible for switching that 19 volt. There could be voltage divider responsible for switching that 19 volt. So depending upon that architecture, there could be a different problem. That's why I say if I put a video on YouTube, that is not the problem for all. That is not a solution for all problem. That is solution for that problem only. Okay.
Specific. Okay.
Yeah, that is specific. We are going to charging section. And after that, we'll go through different architecture of charging section. There could be 24745, VQ 24707, 735. Latest, you talk about 24780, 780, the new charging IC that is used in the latest generation motherboard. So all these ICs having different structure. There could be a four possible. Broadly, if I classify the structure of any charging IC, there could be broadly four charging IC structures. Now, after that, that was S5 state. We were in which state? S5 state. Now we are moving to S3 state, RAM section, right? RAM section.
So S5 means the PC has not booted yet, right?
RAM section and its common faults that related to that section, we'll discuss it. Voltage level of different DDR. You must know that DDR, there are different DDRs used there, DDR3, DDR2, DDR4, DDR3L, different having different voltages levels. So do you know that a single IC could be used for different DDR RAM? Have you used any single IC for all the DDR RAMs? Have you tried it? Bias means kya? What do you mean by bias? Bias means you can manipulate its working. That is the meaning of bias. Okay. So it can be used for 1.5 volt. It can be used for 1.8 volt. It can be used for 1.0.8 volt as well. So DDR3, DDR3L, DDR4. These three will DDRs can be used with single IC. We'll go through that. Mm-hmm. How it is possible. That is only possible if you know the logic, right? Okay. So what are the different supplies of RAM section? VDQ, VTT supply. That is determined by the S3 and S5. Do you know when VTT is generated, when VDDQ supply is generated? Do you all have any idea of RAM section? I'm not talking with Jack and Joe's. They don't have idea about this. So those who have idea, please tell me. Do you know when this VDDQ and VTT voltage generated, S5 state or S3 state? After that, we'll go to the S0 state. We have crossed S3 state now. Now we are going to the S0 state, right? That section is the core or VRM section. Everyone is connected. No problem with connection. Right. Raj, are you there or you got slip? Arum Mugaraj. Can you hear me?
Hearing, sir.
Okay, right. I thought you slept. No problem.
No, sir.
Okay, right. You are awake. Vijo is awake. Santil is awake. Jack, I am seeing Jack. He is awake. Good. Right. So we'll go to the S0 state now first. VRM or core supply. Okay. This is an S0 state supply that after RAM supply is okay. See, all the supply, where all the supply goes, RAM supply, core supply, where this supply goes?
Processor? Core? Goes to processor. I don't think RAM goes to processor.
Both supply goes to processor.
Okay.
RAM supply, there are two supplies in the RAM. VTT supply and VDDQ supply. VDDQ goes to RAM. VTT goes to RAM also and processor also. Right? And when you talk about core is the main supply of CPU. Okay? If you are talking about SoC structure, PCH, CPU, both are included in that. In that, you will have core is the main supply. Okay. Mm-hmm. When you check CPU is short or not, what you say? You check the output of core, right? CPU is short or not. There you check whether CPU is short or not. What does that mean? That means that supply goes to CPU. Na? If the output coil of the core is showing very less impedance, it means there is some problem in the CPU. right? Mm-hmm. Check core supply, it means that supply goes to core. There are many supply that goes to CPU, and we will understand which supply enables which section of CPU and which supply mm-hmm. is responsible for working of which section. You'll go through that as well. It's not that 1.05 is the only requirement of PCH or CPU to enable it. There are many requirements. Mm-hmm. There are PLL mm-hmm. voltages. There are enabling voltages. There are many voltages. Mm-hmm. We'll go through one by one that we use. Okay, for single phase, two phase and three phase. So when you are using, that depends on what? What do you know why the only core IC has phase and all other IC don't have phase?
CPU is really more complex. So it is kind of a hardware that wants or actually is designed so that it needs like so many different kind of voltages. And I think that's why the CPU core IC will have more phases and not everything else requires that many phases. So, maybe even GPU has phases.
Okay, so this was our core section. Now we move on to the next section. Then we'll go with some practical trainings. Most probably you'll get videos for this. This is a CRO and DSO application. Okay, oscilloscope application. How to use oscilloscope first of all. What are the settings that are basic required to have a usefulness of CRO? Because CRO has a many use. CRO has many use. Okay. But we should know that what are the things that we are, that are useful for us. Okay, right. Capture mode, how you use capture mode, how you set the trigger level so that you can test the glitches, like the DRAM reset glitch is there or not. There is RSM reset glitch is there or not. PLT reset is coming properly or not. All these reset signals, this requires capture mode where you have to capture it because it changes its state in nanoseconds. Okay. Mm-hmm. You have to set DSO for capture mode in nanosecond so that while those signals are changing their state, still you are able to capture it.
Yeah.
Okay. And then you can see it in like a photo. It will take a snapshot of it and give you a mm-hmm. photo. Then you can manipulate it, see it upside down, calculate its frequency, time, voltages, everything you can analyze. This will be covered by Nasir sir. He's our more expert in a practical training. Okay. He'll tell you. Better in a better way, but I'm giving you all the overviews here now. Data clock measurement, as I told you, Mr. Jack, without oscilloscope, you cannot measure data and clock. So mm-hmm. you have to have the oscilloscope, and we'll teach that. So before this, you must have a oscilloscope. Gate PWM, you know what is a gate?
Yeah,
this one.
Gate is MOSFET, the terminal, the gate terminal on the MOSFET. Drive it with PWM sometimes.
Yes, PWM frequency. So how you determine what is the duty cycle of PWM, whether that duty cycle is proper or not, that not for that PWM. You must understand what is the duty cycle which is responsible for giving me the perfect voltage at the output.
Okay? Exactly. Yeah,
that duty cycle will be measured with oscilloscope only. You cannot measure it with your multimeter. Never. Mm-hmm. Cannot measure it. Okay, you'll get some voltages. You'll think, oh, some voltage is coming, it's okay. No, it is not possible with that. You have to understand that if 365 kilohertz is required for 5 volt supply at the coil, then there must be a 365 kilohertz frequency at the gate of the MOSFET, right?
Mm-hmm.
Right, so you have to understand that as well, and the duty cycle, we'll go through that as well. We'll understand its theoretical part in the class, and you'll get the videos for practical testing of the CROs. DRAM reset and RSM reset signal. How to check the signal using oscilloscope, we'll deal that. BIOS and LVDS section, without oscilloscope, it's not possible to test a BIOS and LVDS because, you know, with LVDS, there is a differential signal, you must have understand.
Mm-hmm. What is the low voltage differential signaling?
Yeah, what is this? Low voltage differential signaling, right?
Yeah.
So there is a differential signal. What is the meaning of differential signal? We'll come across that when we go through the LVDS section. Same goes with BIOS section. When we go with BIOS section, there are different signals that need to be checked. I'm talking about the supply level section. I'm not talking about its editing and programming. That will be taught differently. Mm-hmm. BIOS has two parts. There is a firmware and there is a hardware.
Yes, hardware, okay? Exactly.
Hardware is its chip that we are talking about. Okay, WinBond, it could be anyone. Okay, that BIOS chip communicates with all the section. What do you mean by BIOS? What is the meaning of BIOS?
Okay.
We'll go further to the RTC section. Okay. What is RTC section? Real time clock. You are good at full form. Real time clock. What is the working of a real time clock? Jack will answer. He is sleeping.
I just don't know.
Okay, no problem. Sleeping. I am here to tell you, brother. I am here to tell you. It is a good thing for me that you are saying that you don't know. I am here to tell you. I'll tell you everything. If you say that you know, I'll go over and over. If you say I don't know, I'll get dig deep. Okay. What is an RTC section? Is a real time clock. Okay. When your motherboard, when your laptop doesn't show time correctly, what does that mean?
Battery is not holding charge, so it's lagging. The clock is not able to keep up.
Which battery?
It forgets the time. The Which RTC battery.
CMOS battery.
RTC battery.
CMOS battery or RTC battery, right? Yeah. So why that is called a real time clock? Can you explain why an RTC section can cause a dead motherboard?
So it has 3-volt supply, and if the 3-volt supply, because of the chip is shorted somehow,
chip is then not it short. Will not capture mode triggering setting for RST signal, reset signal. This will cover in RTC. He will cover, Nasir sir will cover this. We'll take RTC reset, SRTC reset, intruder, inter VRAM, signal functioning. All these 5 signals are most important in the dead cases. When you come across Dell motherboard, there are many problems related to this. 7B problem, 3B problem, 4B problem. Don't go with the beep, okay? Understand one thing. Don't go with the beep. Now I'll move to the next section, SIO section. So in SIO, Super IO, what you will see? Super IO controls the 2, or you can say the 3 state of the motherboard. Now I'm coming to the technicality. There are 3 state of the motherboard. Suspend, always, and run. Okay.
Because the signal is going from the PCS to the SIO.
So who is giving the signal to motherboard actually? SIO it is now?
From, yeah.
Yeah. So there's a common sense SIO is heading. It means SIO will be there. Okay. So Jack Ma, did you got the point? Where is Jack Ma?
I will learn more.
As soon as you plug in your adapter, the voltages that are generated itself, those are
always
supply. Always. Mm-hmm. But when you plug in adapter, at that time only the voltages that are generated itself, that are always supply. Okay. And after pressing the power button. Mm-hmm. Yeah, please, Pabdeep.
So you are saying that plug in the power supply, but battery is also there, right? Inside.
Yeah. Yeah.
So that means these voltages are also there even when you have a battery installed, right?
Yeah, yeah.
Like if the battery is charged.
Yeah, yeah.
So it does not require me to just plug in the power supply. Like if the battery is there, then my main board will always have 3.3 volts always and 5 volts always. Am I correct?
See, when you get a motherboard, you often don't get the battery with that. When I get the motherboard for repairing, you don't get battery with that. Okay. So you always check with power supply. You don't check your motherboard practically with your battery. Do you check motherboard with your practically with your battery? You don't check now. You check with your power supply. What I was saying, when you put an adapter into the motherboard and the voltages that appear in the motherboard, those are called always voltage. Did you got my point? ALW,
yeah.
Always voltage. Yeah. When you press the power button and after that, the voltages that appear in the motherboard that are called suspend voltages. Mm-hmm. Suspend. After pressing power button, you are getting some voltage. That is a suspend voltage. Okay. And what are the run voltages? That run voltages are used to transform those suspend voltage into another level. So PCI is what? Peripheral communication interface. And its version, the more advanced version is Peripheral Communication Interface Express. It is 2.0, 3.0. Many versions are coming. Mm-hmm. What is the changes in the versions are? They're increasing the frequency. When you increase the frequency, you increase the transfer rate. Okay. So it is for better communication.
No, because what is embedded controller? I know it in Lenovo desktops and Lenovo laptop. I saw one, but I never saw in Dell schematic.
It's a signal name. It can be S5 on. It can be S5 enable. It can be main on. It can be any name. There are many names of it.
Okay.
When we'll go to the 3-volt, 5-volt section, we'll see what are the names that comes out of the SIO that is used to generate the 3-volt, 5-volt section.
Okay.
This ECON is generated when IO is triggered. The next section is LVDS section. I've already told you how to check it with using DSO. Now we'll check, we'll understand what is the requirement of LVDS section. How it will generate problem, because our main focus is what? Laptop repairing. We are not here to design any laptop. We are here to repair any laptop. So we should understand what are the faults and what are its troubleshooting. These two points, there should be crystal clear in our mind that these two points we should convey to our mind. Okay. So what are the problems that comes with the LVDS section? Say, Jack.
White display.
White display. Good.
White display.
Yeah. There's a water display problem. No display problem. Dim display problem. Color display problem. Okay. Display coming, going problem. Okay. Right. There can be n number of problems. That the display problem. There could be a problem like this. Display is not coming on screen, but external display is available. That could also be the reason. External display not coming, but there is display on the screen. That could also be the problem. There could be n number of problems. Okay. So that those problems, you have to classify which problem is related to which section. That is the main thing. If you can clarify that in 6 to 7 months, then rest of your life will be easy. This is a golden statement. Okay. So let's move on now. Power signal requirement, it's done. LVDS section. So responsible for what? It is responsible for display in the motherboard system. LVDS section is responsible for display in the motherboard system. So you must understand this point first. And it is a section of which part?
PCH.
PCH or SOC. What is the full form of PCH, Prab?
Platform controller hub.
Very good. I expected that. PCH. Jack, are you clear with this?
Yep.
You know what is the meaning, full form of PCH?
Sorry?
You know the full form of PCH?
Yeah, platform control hub.
Very good. Something? No, platform control hub, to be clear. Don't say something like that. To be clear, exact clear, you say platform control hub, right? Okay. Have you heard about EDP? You might not have seen. Search LVDS and EDP. You will see our Narcissus face. You will go through those two videos. Jack, you will not be able to understand anything. It's in Hindi. So don't waste your time. You search on Google. He will tell you the answer. So this is one of the question that you need to answer. Okay. What are the common faults that are related to LVDS section? Okay. There is no display, dim display, white display, flickering display, water display, colorful display, all the faults that you can keep in your mind. Everything is related to LVDS section. Okay. Sometimes your LVDS may be okay. Okay. Sometimes your LVDS may be okay. The reason could be BIOS. Okay. Because there is data and clock as well. LVDS is section that triggers the LVDS, the display section. Okay. LVDS is a section of PCH that triggers the display section, supplies power to the display section, inverted PWM signal. All these signals are provided to display section from LVDS part of the PCH. Okay. But if still there is no display on the system, it means there is some data mismatching or some data glitch is there that is causing this problem. So that problem could be due to BIOS as well. Okay. Now this is the favorite topic of Nasi sir, PCH, SOC, CPU, RAM, all combined on a single platform. Because both, all these sections don't work individually. They work in a combined way, right? They work with coordination. If PCH is not working, nothing will happen. RAM will not be enabled. CPU will not work properly. So if CPU is not working, RAM will not work properly. Display will not come. System will not on. So you cannot study this individually. First you study this individually, then you have to understand it combined, in a combined way. Everything amalgamated. You must have heard that word, amalgamation. You have to coordinate everything. Then you will get to the exact concept that will help you in troubleshooting, right? So this is a miscellaneous topic that will cover all the coordination sections. Everything will be covered in this RSM reset, PLT reset, DRAM reset, D-Power, okay, DSW, deep sleep well. Have you heard the name deep sleep well? Okay, now the miscellaneous topics. Okay, the topics that are interrelated, not interrelated, that is that you come across very often. So you have BIOS communication system. It means BIOS, ME region. You know what are the regions in BIOS?
ME region, the management engine region.
Boy, that is ME region.
The flash region. Flash region where
flash descriptor.
Data is stayed. Yeah.
Flash descriptor.
But that's all I know. That's it.
You know, there is a BIOS region.
Did not know, but okay.
Yeah, it is a BIOS region. And this BIOS chip is not BIOS. Technically speaking, it is not a BIOS. It is a flash. SPI flash. What
yeah,
is the,
exactly.
That BIOS is a SPI flash. BIOS is a region of that SPI flash. Understand the technicality. Okay. But in general, you say BIOS. BIOS means BIOS. Are you getting my point, what I'm saying? So BIOS region, you got the point. Nasir sir will teach you exactly how you will get to master these things. ME region, CSME, TXC, RSS signature, SMIP addressing, modding, cleaning, editing. One more homework. You get all this full form of these regions. What are the full form of this? ME, CSME, TXC, RSA, SMIP. Okay. Anyone knows? So then the miscellaneous topic, under miscellaneous topic, there will be a thermal section. You all know what is the thermal section?
There has to be some thermal protections.
Temperature related sections. Okay.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah.
With which section it will coordinate?
I think SIO
all,
or maybe PCH.
All
of them. Okay.
All. Why all? Any IC can get heat, can get heated.
Yeah.
Any IC can get shorted. So heating can be issue of any IC. Maximum IC that is supplying the maximum volt to the all section, like 3 volt, 5 volt section. It is supplying 3 volt, 5 volt to all the sections, like 19 volt section. It is supplying 19 volt to all the motherboard. To every section of the motherboard. So these IC may get heated up due to any auxiliary component getting problem. Okay. So that needs thermal protection. Na? So because of that single IC, we don't want our system to get more affected. Right.
Yeah.
But that is controlled by thermal section. So there could be many problems related to thermal section. So we cannot classify it into a particular topic. So it has a, the most common problem is on off problem. What it will do? When the temperature goes to 150 degree, it will shut down your
system. Shuts off.
So you get on and you get off. You get on and you get off. So on-off problem can be one of the cause due to thermal section mishappening. Are you getting it, Jack? I'm clear to you?
Yeah.
You're overexcited. Right. After that, you will understand the board view functioning. After that, power supply tricks, how to find an always supply. That is purely practical. How to find this motherboard is always or suspend. How you will find that? How you will have to recognize that? After that, we'll go to the sound section, USB, hard disk, optical drive, green clock, ASUS RAM disable section, the conversion, all that data. That is a miscellaneous thing that will be dealt in a proper way. Okay. After that, thank you.